Okay, folks, we're going to get started. I'm Dan Rundy. I hold the Schreier Chair here at CSIS, and we're going to be having a conversation about food, jobs, and technology, public-private partnerships in the post-2015 development agenda. I think we're very appreciative of our friends at UNIDO, which is the United Nations Industrial Development Organization, who helped us make this happen today. I think it's a particularly timely conversation. You all have their bios in front of you, but I think we've got two distinguished panels to unpack these issues. I want to make three basic points, and then I'm going to turn it over to the panelists. One is that I think there's been a significant evolution in this conversation over the 12 years I've been working on these issues. I think we've moved from a conversation that was, this is a nice to have, or this is a CSR conversation, or this is a nuisance, or this is privatization of development, or this is dodging your ODA responsibilities, to a far more sophisticated conversation on the third sector side, on the government side, and on the private sector side. And I think in the comments of each of the sectors and the perspectives that I think implicitly that evolution and how this conversation has changed. Second is, if you look at the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals that were announced and enacted in the year 2000 that are going to, in essence, come due in 2015, the next round, the negotiations that is beginning, the pre-negotiations, if you look at the report, the high-level panel report, or you look at the response from the Secretary General's office, the conversation is far more sophisticated and nuanced than 15 years ago about the role of the private sector, far more sophisticated and nuanced about how we need to work collectively and cooperatively. And then finally, the third point I want to make is next week there's something called the Global Partnership, which is in essence, if the MDGs are the what about the future of development, then the global partnership is in some ways you should think about it as the how of the future of development. And this is it's a collective secretariat between the OECD and UNDP where it's trying to bring together a broad set of stakeholders, both donors and middle-income countries and developing countries and the private sector to have a larger conversation. That's hard to do, and that's why they call it the Global Partnership, and the conversations in Mexico City, and so the conversation there is going to be, one of the discussions is about the role of the private sector. It's one of the four central pillars. So it's now become an almost what I've described in the past as this is a politically correct discussion. This is now on the agenda. You have to talk about this if you want to be a leader in one of these sectors. The challenge is how you scale it, how you operationalize it, and how you make this successful. Those are the three big challenges. So with that, without any further ado, I'm going to ask my friend Kazuki Kitaoka, who's from UNIDO, to start us off and provide UNIDO's point of view. I'm just going to also just flag that my friend Kazuki has to leave a little bit before 4 because it's the World Bank IMF meetings, and so you, as you guys all know, there are multiple things going on at the same time, and so we're lucky and we appreciate UNIDO's support, and we also understand that he's got to take over. But we're very fortunate, my friend Barbara Chrysler, who's also with UNIDO, who's going to be with us the entire time and will be able to represent UNIDO very, very well and very ably. So Kazuki, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dan, and it's always a great highlight for me when there is an event here with you and at this important and prestigious center here in Washington, D.C., particularly this beautiful weather has really an attraction factor for all of us to come here as often as possible. And I think we are also talking about a topic that is really pertinent for development, for the future of our development policy, our global development policy, as it is enrolling in the UN discussions at the intergovernmental level. But I think much more than in the past, this is something that is not only happening at the intergovernmental level, but this is something that is also involving increasingly business, civil society organizations, and populations at large, because this is essentially the future of our planet and of our populations that we're talking about here. for the next generation or so. And as these negotiations in New York are unfolding, the UN Development Group, that's a grouping of 30 different UN agencies that are dealing with all kinds of things from children to industrial development, like my organization, UNIDO, have been starting a global conversation on the role of private enterprise in development. And that is partly why we are welcoming this conversation today here at the CSIS. And to an extent, we consider this event today actually as a kickoff, as a start to this global conversation and consultation. And we are particularly happy that this is starting here in DC, where, of course, all the different partners of the private sector, as well as USAID, can be present with us. We are also happy that this consultation is being co-hosted by the government of Spain and the government of the United States. And as such, we are also happy that for the next 6 months, we will have a very intensive dialogue in different countries on this. Coming back to the development agenda, I think today's development challenges are perhaps more complex than the ones that we saw in the 1990s. And we certainly see a world that is much more interdependent, and also the actors are much more diverse, as we have seen. And at the same time, we have also recognized that that we actually have the means today for eradicating poverty in all of its different dimensions, and the different dimensions being economic deprivation, social inclusion, and environmental degradation. And of course, the private sector will take an important step and play an important role in addressing these issues. The new development agenda this therefore needs to live up to this complex task, and we need to move away from isolated small development pilot activities to a much more transformative and broad agenda that really includes a transformative process for all of us, for all of our societies, to fully eradicate poverty and achieve sustainable development in the long term. I will not go into all the details that I have received as talking points, because this would take me half an hour probably to read. But
and we're all grateful for that.
No, it's just looking. But the perhaps one one aspect that is particularly important to me as we look at the next development agenda. At the moment, in the intergovernmental process, governments are looking at 19 different focus areas, everything from poverty to peace and security. And what we are arguing in this process as UNIDO, as industrial development organization, is that private enterprise really has a transformative, a crucial role to play when it is coming to all of these aspects. Whether we are talking about input factors into industry, such as the workforce, or water, or electricity, or even raw materials, all of these need to be managed in a responsible manner, and they can be managed in a much more responsible manner than they are done today. And through that, we can actually advance the sustainable development agenda on the input side of industry, and of course on the output side of industry, when we are thinking about the production of emissions, the production of chemicals. On that side as well, if we manage industrialization and private sector activities better, and this is a private sector activity, this is not a government activity as we see it, then we can really find a positive and a business-friendly way towards sustainable development. And ultimately, of course, what we believe is if business is doing well, and if there is more interaction and interdependency between countries also on the business level, we can also advance on peace and security ultimately. Now, let me come to the end by inviting you to this global conversation that I was mentioning at the beginning. We will open a website actually on that, and we would invite everybody who is watching also outside of this room to engage with us on this particular agenda. We think that this is a global conversation that needs to happen. We hope that this will happen in a very engaged and proactive manner. And with this, back to you, Dan. Thank you very much for your attention. And I'm looking forward to a very good conversation.
I think what Kazuki was saying about the central role of the private sector, one of the things I've been struck by is if we'd had this conversation 10 or 15 years ago, that would have gotten lip service, but it wouldn't have sounded real. It now sounds a lot more sincere and real to me across all the stakeholders, and that this is a common theme. If you read the high-level panel report or you look at the conversation that's going on in Mexico, the fact that it's so central to the discussion, I think what Kazuki's points are really well taken. I do think you see it as this, it's a cross-cutting issue, and business wants to be at the table. But I want to hear, before we hear from my friends in the private sector, I want to hear from Mr. Ricardo Michel, who's with USAID. The AID has been working on public-private partnership issues for at least 12 or 13 years. My friend Holly Wise, who was the founder of the Global Development Alliance, is a retired Foreign Service officer and was really put this together in 1999 and 2000 before partnerships were cool or working and was sort of seeing out on the horizon, and a number of thoughtful Foreign Service officers at AID sort of saw the changing world and said, we need to do more to partner with others. And so Ricardo and others have inherited a very successful set of partnerships and a lot of lessons learned. So Ricardo, the floor is yours.
Good. Thank you, Dan. Good afternoon, everyone. Dan, I should thank you again for UNCSIS for inviting me here to speak. And also thank you personally as the former director of the Office of Global Development Alliances. He's established a strong foundation, which has evolved. So I sit here before you as the director of the Center for Transformational Partnerships. So not only is it real, it's also cool now to put transformational partnerships in your name. As the director of the center, I actually represent a team that's dedicated to USAID's mission. And the mission reads to partner to end extreme poverty and promote resilient democratic societies while advancing our security and prosperity. In 2001, as Dan mentioned, USAID developed this Global Development Alliance as a mechanism to allow us to partner more broadly with the private sector. And since then, it's become really the flagship tool for the agency in terms of our ability to build these public-private partnerships. Over the last decade, it's evolved. We've seen that this has gone more from market access into a powerful market tool, which really aligns our interests in terms of development interests and businesses' commercial interests. Today, with over a decade of experience in building public-private partnerships for development, we recognize that the effective partnerships not only catalyze ideas and assets which are channeled towards addressing our development issues, but also foster private sector-led growth in these emerging economies. From our experience, we believe that the most effective partnerships are those that, one, clearly align business interests with development objectives, also catalyze private sector participation, and most importantly, employ cost-effective, scalable, and sustainable development models for the long term. Just last week, I'm proud to say the agency launched the U.S. Global Development Lab to spearhead this bold approach. It's to invent, test, and scale new innovations, breakthrough innovations, while partnering to transform what we call the development enterprise. Through the lab, we will be collaborating with entrepreneurs, world-class experts from corporations, NGOs, universities, science and research institutions by applying science, technology, innovation, and partnerships to address these intractable challenges that we've been facing. Our goal is to find solutions that are better, faster, and cheaper to save and improve lives of over 200 million people in the next 5 years. One a year.
So we need to take the long view in development. That's really the long view.
But all this to say that U.S. Global Development Lab is really demonstrating how USAID is evolving to make long-term progress on the post-2015 development agenda. We're positioning ourselves to produce breakthrough development innovations, but also building a global platform to scale. We will discover, test, but most importantly, scale proven solutions to address these challenges. These are the solutions with which we will achieve the post-2015 development agenda. These are solutions that will expand the focus beyond just the economics pillar to actually include both the social and environmental pillars as equally critical elements of sustainable development. As a global leader in development, we recognize our capacity to catalyze groundbreaking collaborative partnerships at all levels, building alliances to expand that impact. We now have the tools, the technologies, and approaches to end extreme poverty and its most devastating consequences, including widespread hunger and preventable child death within the next two decades. And we take this seriously. For us, this is a unique moment in history. We have the potential to combat HIV/AIDS, achieve universal education, and ensure environmental sustainability. We can achieve the post-2015 development agenda, particularly through technology and innovation and science and partnerships of all types. So, for example, we're currently working with Duke University. We're working with them to help test and scale a new technology that actually has the potential to save hundreds of thousands of lives of children. When we think about HIV/AIDS transmission, we know that 90% of new HIV infections are due to mother-to-child transmission. However, when newborns receive antiretroviral drugs within the first 24 hours, their ability or the probability of their catching HIV/AIDS is reduced from over 40 to 50% down to less than 5%. So with Duke, through their program that we're sponsoring with them, students actually invented what's called the Pratt Pouch. The Pratt Pouch is a ketchup packet foil type pouch, which actually holds one dose of antiretroviral drugs. But the innovation here is it preserves it for over a year without the use of refrigeration. So we're actually now working with them to conduct clinical trials in Zambia. It's expanding to other countries. And we hope to be in a position where this is something that we scale. And you can imagine the impact this will have in the rural communities without access to power, et cetera, et cetera. And in fact, the World Health Organization named the Pratt Pouch one of the 10 most innovative products in 2012. That aside, we do also realize and recognize that there's a changing landscape in terms of development. Private sector resource flows into a lot of the countries where we work have dwindled, or I should say have outpaced our development assistance. The statistics we've seen, it's close down to 90%, where we're less than 10% of these resource flows. So this is a significant difference from 20 years ago. We are not the 800-pound gorilla. It's not our resources that's going to move the meter. Therefore, we have to partner and influence those private sector flows. So the boundaries of development sector, as we know it, are disappearing. Public, private, and nonprofit sectors globally and locally are all part of the development equation and solutions for tomorrow. All segments of American society also are demonstrating desire to engage in global challenges. We work with youth, we work at universities, faith-based organizations, startups, and corporations. So these trends not only demonstrate the changing development landscape, but also imply the need for more integrated approaches, and we've taken this seriously. Most development challenges require capabilities that no one actor alone possesses. We recognize the need for these integrated approaches and are working with the private sector to expand the use of strategic alliances to help achieve shared development objectives. Working with the private sector, in our eyes, is actually no longer a luxury. It's a necessity. Today, more than half of the 100 largest economies of the world are actually corporations. Right? So as a result of this landscape, U.S. companies are increasingly looking at development as a core strategic issue rather than a matter of corporate philanthropy. A recent UN Global Compact survey of over 750 CEOs found that more than three-quarters of them believe that companies should engage in industry collaborations and multi-stakeholder partnerships to address sustainability and development goals. So over the past decade at USAID, we've built over 1,500 partnerships. We've worked with over 3,500 unique partner organizations. This has allowed us on a combined basis to leverage close to $20 billion, all in the advancement of development goals. And on average, this is about raising $3 to every $1 of USAID foreign assistance. So this effort has really put us at the forefront of a new era of development. We talk about a new model of development. This is one that seeks to leverage the creativity, the technology, and the resources of the private sector to promote sustainable and scalable global development. However, PPPs aren't just about leveraging money. They're about building relationships between the private sector, public organizations, and local populations. They're also about collaboration to develop sustainable programs, to implement long-lasting solutions to poverty, alleviation, and food security. And they're about achieving the Millennium Development Goals together, providing a model for us to achieve the post-2015 development agenda. By partnering with the private sector, we hope to stimulate private sector-led development and exponentially increase the impact of our foreign assistance investments. As I mentioned earlier, the agency recently unveiled the U.S. Global Development Lab, which will lead a more comprehensive approach to achieving these post-2015 development agenda through the integration of science, technology, innovation, and, of course, partnerships. Our partnership model also will evolve to accommodate this new approach. The creation of our lab will allow a diverse set of partners to join USAID efforts to discover, incubate, and scale development innovations in sectors like water, health, food security, and nutrition, which can reach hundreds of millions of peoples. We're looking for breakthroughs in the order of the magnitude of the Green Revolution, quite honestly. But in conclusion, I just want to note that through the lab, we can harness the power of applied science, research, technologies, while forging innovative partnerships with the private sector and academia to leverage our talent, take risks, and use them, and use our American creativity and ingenuity to transform lives more than ever before. The big picture, however, at this time, is our vision is to collaborate globally with stakeholders, all types, together defining our strategy to achieve the post-2015 development agenda through partnerships in a way that build on the knowledge that we already have and bring to the table innovative ideas so that we can invest in interventions that really work to solve our development challenges more cost efficiently and cost effectively. And we will continue to evolve our development approach to expand our impact, increase our scale effectiveness and sustainability to achieve the post-2015 development agenda. So, thank you, Dan.
Thanks, Ricardo. That's fantastic, and it's very encouraging to hear about the launch of the new development lab, and I know many people are going to be looking forward to connecting with you afterwards about that. It's very exciting. Is there a website for it?
Yes, it's actually www.usglobaldevelopmentlab.gov.
Okay, great. Sarah, thank you for being with us here with Oracle, and Oracle thinks a lot about the issue of education and development, and it works on leveraging technology for that purpose. I suspect Oracle's gone on an intellectual journey over time as it thinks about development, as it thinks about education, and it thinks about what Oracle contributes to the development conversation. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Dan, thanks again for having me. And I think we met originally when you were at GDA.
Yes.
A long time ago. And I've been with Oracle for 10 years.
And we're both still very young, so it's
we're
good.
We're very young. We started our careers very young, which is actually true. Oracle takes, for those of you who aren't familiar with Oracle, that's normal. And I always tell everybody, I quiz people, I'm like, well, what do you know about Oracle? And they said they read my website. I'm like, well, that means you know nothing. We're a Fortune 70 company. We have 122,000 employees around the world, and we're one of the largest software companies on the planet. We're the largest business software company. We're headquartered in California. We're a Silicon Valley dream company. Come up. We're .com. 38 years, I think, old we are. And we operate in 154 countries around the world. We operate in pretty much in every country we sell our products, with the exception of, North Korea and South Sudan and things like that. And the way the Oracle business model functions is similar to how our philanthropic and our education partnerships function. We don't play well by ourselves. We play better with partners, and we play better with local partners. So when we're looking at a country like Laos, we're looking at a country like Nigeria, we will have Oracle employees who live there and work there and who have at oracle.com as their email address, but we find local partners. And one of our things we do, I think, that kind of gets overlooked when we talk about philanthropy is our partnership network. All of our partners globally have to follow basically US SEC guidelines. That means they do their books properly. The ethics on their sales are done in accordance with our culture, and that, I think, breeds maybe a better business culture that ends certain negative behaviors. But when we look at education globally, especially in the US and all over the world, you see a huge skills gap, and everybody always hears about the skills gap. And I have very sophisticated people who sometimes ask me, why does Oracle care so much about education? We pump about $2 billion in kind and direct dollars into philanthropic endeavors all over the world. They're all done through partnerships. And why do you do it? And it depends on who's asking me and why, and I will say, well, because stupid people don't make software and stupid people don't buy it. Or smart people make software and smart people buy it, and we just need more smart people. You need an educated government, you need educated businesses, and et cetera, to build these things or to be buying these things. So we run, our largest program is the Oracle Academy. We have a couple things around the world that are a little bit smaller. But Oracle Academy is kind of our signature program, and what we do is we do an educate the teacher model, because we don't talk to students. We're a big corporation. The teachers talk to the students. And if you think about it in the U.S. context, it's high school or community college. It's a workforce development program. And it's it's purely altruistic. You know, like I said, most of you will never know who Oracle is. Most people never buy Oracle products. Committees of people buy Oracle products. Governments buy Oracle products. It's not something you just go to Staples and buy off the shelf or go online, it'll blow up your laptop. So, you know, it's coming from a very altruistic endeavor. And we like to scale. And I always give the good example of a great partnership we had, and we actually have a good one in Egypt too, despite the Arab Spring, started in Romania about 8 or 9 years ago. The president of Romania met our president, who happens to have some Romanian heritage that's very directly connected to him, just pure coincidence. And he contacted the Minister of Education and said, can you take a look at this? We trained 15 teachers. Oracle pays for the trainer. Trained 15 teachers. They went out and trained as many students as they could. It was their computer science class. And the following year, we trained 30 teachers. And the following year, a little bit more. And then eventually, we were able to hire out of that teacher cadre those teachers to be the teacher trainer. So we're not flying in Americans or Europeans to do it. We're hiring local Romanians. And very soon, the government started hiring them directly. And at this point, years and years later, it's actually the best country we have. And I use it to shame Americans all the time. They run it completely autonomously. They make a conference call. We actually remove their numbers from our data because it skews the entire data set when you talk about how much we're giving or things of that nature. Similarly, in Egypt, because we were also working with the kitchen cabinet of the government, not necessarily the top official, the Arab Spring happened while we were going to do this marquee 400 teacher sign-up training event in Cairo the year of the Arab Spring. I got a lot of calls because people were like, why didn't you warn us? I would have no idea about it. It's not the kind of politics I cover. And nobody could communicate with us for about, you know, for as long as the internet was down. When the internet came back online, 900 teachers enrolled. And that was partially from our partners, but also from the teachers who had pre-enrolled who were going around door to door, encouraging other teachers to sign up for this training, and 720 teachers showed up. And our goal for Egypt has always been that, you know, we train the Egyptian teachers and then they can go out throughout the rest of the Middle East and do our training in Arabic. Our courses aren't taught in Arabic, but or not the paperwork and all the stuff online is not done in Arabic, but it can be taught in whatever language. We do the same in Spanish and Chinese. And what we teach is computer science at the high school level. We teach intro to computer science, SQL, PL, SQL, and Java. In the U.S. alone, there are 60,000 Java jobs. All of what we teach philanthropically leads to an industry certification. And two of the languages we teach are not Oracle languages. They are ubiquitous to the entire computer science world. The way we like to structure our partnerships is we take a step, then they take a step. You take a step, we take a step. So we're working in lockstep. We occasionally, and the bad examples of partnerships, which we learn from, are government officials who want to bribe. I've heard a lot of VPs scream at government officials for insulting the country by trying to steal from steal from us, which means you're stealing from children as well. We had another country where they selected all the teachers. This is a sophisticated computer science course. You really need to have algebra, a college degree to kind of teach it, to learn, not to learn it, but to teach it. And we had a specific country, which we use a lot to give examples, but we don't say their name. And it was all the teachers' choices were political choices. They went to the villages and they picked the wife of the school teacher. You know, they did it that way. A lot of these teachers don't have power in their schools, so you really can't teach computer science without electricity. Had never seen a computer. And I had the U.S. ambassador come out, a couple of government officials come out, and they really pumped these teachers up. You're going to save your country from poverty. You know, you can be a data hub. You can do all this amazing. You can be the next India. And, you know, 5 days later, these teachers are in tears. Mm. And we didn't want to be in tears. We're very selfish. We don't like bad feelings either. So we work with governments to make sure that we're helping them select the teachers, it's not an autonomous thing, that there is a threshold to entry. And we have better examples always and always every year when it's like, well, Christmas can't move, neither can our due date. To help, you know, countries understand that, you know, and we don't have to do this. I get baited a lot too with, oh, your competitor just gave us $100 million. I said, well, great, you don't need my money. some of the times I'm just like, you don't really get how this works. This is philanthropy. This isn't, you know, I don't need you to like me. I need you to help the people you're trying to serve. and that's what we're trying to do. And we look at it in a global capacity. Our barrier to entry is a return phone call. It's very simple. Our people are hungry. I actually have to call you. I'm calling you next. By the way, I have some people who want to talk to USAID because we want to help grow these in countries. And it's not something we can do, because what we do is we build software. We don't network educators, but we do talk to people who do. And that's how we become successful. And hopefully our goal is always to make our programs sustainable where we're not involved. And we've done something similar in Chicago, and I just mention it because I saw an article recently. Chicago is now considered the fifth largest tech employment market in the country. About 4 years ago, Cisco, Oracle, IBM, and Microsoft all started pumping in our philanthropy into the high schools in Chicago. I like to think we had something to do with improving that.
Sarah, thank you very much. Trevor, you all have been thinking about development from a number of perspectives. You have clients, you have philanthropic clients, government clients, host country government clients, donor clients. You were kind enough to support a conference we did about the future of public-private partnerships, strengthening, which we produced a commentary called The Future of Public-Private Partnerships back in October, strengthening a powerful instrument for global development, which built on a couple of things we've done here at CSIS. One is seizing the opportunity in public-private partnerships that came out in November of 2011 with my co-author and friend Anna Saito Carson, who's not with us today, but one of my colleagues here at CSIS. And we've done a lot around this issue of partnerships through our shared opportunity, and you helped us further that discussion, and I think this builds on all of that work. You just yesterday launched a change readiness initiative. You're thinking about multi-stakeholder challenges, whether it's youth, whether it's food, whether it's this ability of a society to improve its ability to react to challenges and capitalize on challenges. How is KPMG thinking about multi-sector partnerships, and how should we be thinking about this in the context of the post-2015 development agenda?
Thanks, Dan. It's a pleasure to be here. It's particularly nice to be up on the stage because I can see the trees. I often wondered why people agreed to do this and put themselves through it, now I know you actually get to see the trees. Thanks, Dan, for the introduction. I have to say, after that, I'm not entirely sure whether I'm in the wrong room or you are. You could tell me at the end. I was thinking back to some of the things that I was looking at. I can remember when I first started working in international development, and that was back in 1989. I can remember an American friend of mine actually quoting Mark Twain to me. So I actually had to go away and look this up last night to make sure I got it right, because my memory is not what it was. Mm. And he said one of the things to remember about being badged as an expert is an expert is actually just an ordinary person from the next town over. Mm. So I think we would see ourselves very much as ordinary people actually in this debate and trying to engage with it in it as equals. And I think that's one of the key things in looking at public-private partnerships is for all parties to actually come into this with a view that they are genuinely going to collaborate. So KPMG, you probably know us as auditors, but we're more than that. And I have to say I'm delighted to announce that I'm not an auditor. And
is this like a support group?
Yeah, you know, it's kind of pretty good. We've got a
hi, Trevor, right?
Yeah. I can sit in the circle and hold hands in a minute, right. But we've got 155,000 people based in 156 countries around the world, and the way in which we operate is wherever we can, we use local resource. If we can't use local, we use regional. If we can't use regional, we bring in, I was going to say global experts, but that's terrible after what I've just said, global specialists. For us, we recognize, and I think exactly the same as Sarah was saying, we recognize that for us to be successful as a business, we need our people to be successful, the communities that we operate in to be successful, and our clients to be successful. And that's really why we're engaged in the development debate. As I said, we have offices in 156 countries, and that includes most of the fun places in the world. So we stayed in Sierra Leone throughout the conflict. We've got offices in Myanmar. You know, we're in Mongolia and Nepal and all the rest of the places, Afghanistan. And we engage our local staff in those offices. So for us, it's not an academic thing. it's something that affects the lives of our people every day in their countries. So in terms of our business, we focused our engagement in development around the Millennium Development Goals. And we've done that really from the start of the process. And we, just to give you one example of some of the engagement, we started back in 2008 and we looked at our own energy footprint. And we thought if we were going to go out and advise clients on it, we kind of might be a good idea to do it ourselves. So we had a look at our energy footprint, and our global board decided that we should reduce our energy profile by 25% by 2015. By 2010, we'd already taken it down by 29%, and that represented a cash saving to the business of $220 million. Since then, we've reduced it by another 9%, and we're on track to bring it down by over 40% by 2015. Now, that's not just from a moral perspective. It's also good business. It's actually cost-effective. It generates reductions in expenses for us. So I wanted to turn now to the Millennium Development Goals and the Sustainable Development Goals. And I mean, one of the things about it is I think we're starting to have, and I think we need to have an honest conversation about where we got to with the Millennium Development Goals and where we've still got to go. A lot of the things that you see are very slick, they're very shiny, and they're great presentations.
I resemble that remark.
but we need to be clear. So, I mean, if you look at the MDG, there's been some great progress. I mean, they galvanized the world. They got people to actually really focus on the challenges of extreme poverty and to look at the situation. So we've got a world today that's more prosperous than it's ever been. There's half a billion people, fewer people living in abject poverty than there were when we started on the MDGs. There's been dramatic improvements in basic education, in health, in water, sanitation. Technology, technological innovation is actually transforming the way in which we interact with each other, the demands we place on government, both for services, for accountability, and for transparency. And it's enhancing government institutions and helping us to actually think about how we can provide new solutions to the challenges that we face. Cross-border flows, which have been facilitated by this, of goods and services have internationalized many societies around the world. And today, as Ricardo said, foreign direct investment is now five times the level of official development assistance to Africa. So it's pretty clear that the private sector is a major player. However, there's been some great progress, but I think we need to be clear. If you look at where we are, if you just look at the MDG around halving extreme poverty, great success. It was achieved by 2010. You look underneath that was achieved really as a result of progress mainly in China and India. If you look at Africa today, and you take sub-Saharan Africa from where it was in 1990, it had 290 million people living in extreme poverty. Today, the figure is 414 million, and that's a success. I don't want to be around when there's failures, right? So why do we engage in this? As I've said, it's good for our communities, it's good for our business. We're absolutely clear that for us, as our business, we will be more successful, stable, peaceful, sustainable world. And we're absolutely clear that for that to happen, people have to have opportunity to learning, to health, and to market opportunities. And I would add, after what you said yesterday, Dan, to democratic processes as well. He told me off for that yesterday.
In favor of democratic processes.
That's what you said.
Yeah, yes, exactly.
And we believe, though, that underpinning all this has to be responsible business, and that has to be underpinned by long-term ethical behavior that correlates with higher financial returns, lower volatility, and a lower cost of capital for business. So it makes good sense all the way around. And we think there are new markets in Africa, there's new markets in Asia. If you look at growth and you look at where growth is coming from, it's not coming from the traditional markets of Europe or America. Growth is now coming from Africa, it's coming from Asia. So we engage in all of this agenda, and we engage in four ways. We engage in the policy dialogue with our friends at UNGC, with the World Business Council on Sustainable Development, with the Global Commission on Economy and Environment, and I could go on and on and on. We engage in all of these fora. We engage through our traditional sort of corporate citizenship agenda, which is linked back into the center of our business. And we're engaged really from a global level with global initiatives right the way down to villages. So I'll give you some examples there very quickly. We work with the Millennium Village and also with the Millennium Cities Initiative. We're supporting the village of Pemba in Tanzania completely in terms of its development journey. We've been working with the Millennium Cities on a whole series of programs across Africa. And take a look at bamboo bicycles, by the way, if you're thinking about trying to get healthy, and I'm not a good advertisement for that. Bamboo bikes, well worth a look. Developed through Millennium Cities with support from KPMG. It's sustainable, it makes good use of local resources, it's cost effective, and it creates jobs for young people in Africa. So go bamboo bikes. But we're also involved in things like Alive and Kicking, which is a HIV/AIDS initiative, which actually recycles leather collected from the streets in Nairobi and turns them into footballs. So it's great for the kids. It gets the message out to the community. So you can have to kick me if I could go on for ages. But I'm going to just turn very quickly to something that Dan mentioned, which is a change readiness index that we've produced that looks at 90 countries around the world and looks at their ability to actually respond both to shocks and opportunities. And there's some interesting findings there in terms of sort of trade. We found that the more open the market, the broader the macroeconomic policies and the greater clarity, the more active the labor market policies, and the better access to human capital, the greater the trade. However, it's not a perfect storm. We've also found countries at the bottom where a lot of those things don't apply, such as Venezuela, where they're still getting 50% of their GDP from oil because, obviously, because of the extractors. I just wanted to very quickly turn to trade, and I wanted to pick up the case of Africa and just develop that a little bit more. I've been attending the World Bank IMF meetings this week, and I've been listening to sessions on Africa Rising, which were great and really interesting. But just to get to the bottom of that, Africa's share of global trade, which is growing rapidly, is 3%. Okay, so it's growing from a very, very small base. It's got a 3% share of global trade, despite having 15% of the global population. It's a continent of 55 countries. It's got a large number of economic jurisdictions, which make it very difficult to do business. And many of those markets lack scale. 15 of those countries are landlocked, which gives them real problems in terms of access to market and the ability to actually take, whether it be agricultural produce or other things, and get them to market quickly. There's a higher cost as a result of that. And I was looking at, last week there was a summit in Brussels. 70 European African countries actually met to talk about how they can improve the political and the economic environment between Europe and Africa. The big issue was trade. And I just want to look at that just very quickly. When I actually looked into the communique and then followed up with some of the details, I was rather surprised, and maybe this is just me, you probably won't be. 65% of the exports to Europe from Africa come from five countries, Algeria, Nigeria, South Africa, Libya, and Morocco, 65%, okay? If you look at China, the figure goes up to 90%, comes from five countries. So yes, there's a tremendous improvement in trade. There's a lot of opportunity for Africa to grow. There's a lot of opportunity for Africa to develop its markets, but there's a long, long way to go. I'll stop there, but I can, in questions, I've got some comments I'd pick up.
Brilliant. So thank you. I think you've heard that there's a consent, there are challenges and opportunities in development. We're in a different place from 15 years ago. I think there's a consensus we need multi-sector collaboration to make confront these challenges. I think there's a much deeper consensus that's baked in about the role of the private sector. And I think you've heard across this panel that those themes. I want to put a question to Trevor and Sarah about what do you need from governments and multilateral agencies like UNIDO to be better partners? And then I want to hear from Ricardo about what do you need from the private sector or the third sector from them to be better partners? And I'll just make one additional point that sort of someone was talking in the green room about, and we see this in the U.S. system too. The good news is that public-private partnerships have become a lot more accepted as an approach. The tricky thing has been when you're a company and you hear from five or six different U.S. government agencies, or in the case of someone in the green room saying they've heard from 20 or 30 U.N. agencies if they're a particular company. So I think the good news is we've got the public sector thinking about this, but I think we're starting to create, there's some interesting challenges around how we talk about this, et cetera. But I think that I suspect that's something I know that's in one of the issues that wasn't a problem, if I can call it a problem, maybe a challenge, maybe an opportunity 10 years ago, because it was just even hard getting this conversation off the ground. And I think we're in a much better place than we are 10 years ago. So, but I'm going to start with Trevor, then Sarah, then Ricardo. Trevor.
Okay, thanks. And I'll be brief compared to what I just said. Okay. I suppose first thing, shared language. I think we need to be clear what we're talking about. There's a lot of confusion about public-private partnerships. I was at a meeting the other day, and it was about building dams. I was at a meeting the following day, and it was really about fundraising. It was trying to tap up the private sector for some contributions. It's all described as public-private partnerships. Mm-hmm. So we need to be very clear about what we're talking about. We need to be very clear what the rules of engagement are. We need to be very clear what it is we're actually trying to achieve in a particular initiative, how we'll know whether we've done it, and what good looks like, really, as a result of that. I think the other thing is, I think certainly from our perspective, we need scale. One of the things that we've done with our own global development initiative is we focused our engagement globally on fewer, larger partners, in the sense that we're spending far more, but we're doing it with fewer initiatives, because we felt that what we were doing was just scattergunning so many things that it was just so difficult to manage all the interrelated processes. We needed to focus and we needed to get scale. And I think finally, I would say, be clear about the results. Be absolutely open about what's not working and what's working, what's not working, and what lessons can be learned to improve future collaboration and future programming.
That's great. Sarah?
I would definitely agree on the definition. I had a one-year meeting with a multilateral development bank where they still could not define public-private partnership for me, and they really just wanted $20 million in cash. And that's not what we do when you're talking to our philanthropy, and you're not going to take our curriculum and change it and somehow then say it's better after we spent $1 billion to make it what it is. So definitely definitions. I think also having different avenues and understanding the way our public-private partnership program has been described to me is it's a ruler. We can bend it a little bit this way. We can bend it a little bit this way for the local flavor, et cetera. But we cannot do this. We cannot completely, you know, we teach software. So if your schools don't have computers, if you don't have broadband, then we're not the right people for you to partner with. Doesn't mean you shouldn't have a conversation with us, because maybe one day in 2 or 3 years, and we also in turn follow where that goes. But understanding what we're offering and knowing that we're not going to reinvent it because you are, you know, USAID and you're so important, and we're beholden to you. We're beholden to our shareholders, really. But when it comes to this, we want to make sure we have a positive result. We don't do it for PR. Should probably tell more people about what we do, but it's actually on purpose. Our salespeople don't talk about this on purpose. But making sure that there's an avenue, so if we went to USAID, which I haven't gone in a while, so I'm just putting you on the spot. Mm-hmm. But if we went to X organization, we could see, here's public-private partnership and maybe a definition, but contact, click here, and somebody can get back to you, so we can have that access.
I think the beauty of partnerships is it's a two-way street, and I have to echo the sentiments that I've heard here in terms of what we need from the private sector. The shared language, I couldn't say more. As a former banker, to Trevor's point, public-private partnerships to me before coming into development space meant massive infrastructure programs, not working with host country governments to implement small programs. That said, I also have the pleasure of working with Trevor on a partnership that we've developed through DevEx and strategically thinking about how do we bring these two together to establish that common platform of a language. I would say that we also need patience. As multilaterals, as bilaterals, we can't move at the speed of business. However, I think that to the extent we can be patient with those processes and keep the longer-term goals in line, it allows us more room. A lot of times when we engage, we may be engaging later on in the process or with a shorter time frame. And for us, because of those processes and moving that aircraft carrier, we can't keep up, if you will, with how business would like to be on the ground and implementing right away. So we'll have to meet at the middle. But I think if we're charting towards that same North Star, again, echoing what Trevor said, having those goals identified, what are we trying to achieve? And then being willing to have those mature dialogues. Some of our learnings have been from partnerships that have not worked. But what's worked within the partnerships that hadn't worked is that we talked about those issues. What are you really trying to get out of this relationship? And where are we not meeting those needs? And being willing to reevaluate and recalibrate those. And for us, that's not an easy task as we plan and contract, et cetera. But without those discussions, we know that the next partnership won't be as fruitful. So you know, that kind of dialogue is critical. And the last thing I would say is that we have to, as Sarah and I are going to do after this, mm-hmm. begin to engage early and often. Because of the processes, because of the plumbing and how it works, again, trying to keep up with the speed of business becomes tricky. So for us, if we have a broader dialogue, we're engaging earlier, not just once we think we have a solution to see if it works, but actually one of the things we're trying to do in the lab is actually co-identify what are those constraints that we can address through the private sector, co-collaborate around what are some of the solutions, and ultimately when we find that solution, it's a lot easier for us to scale it together.
Okay, time for two questions. I'm hoping to hear from my friend Michael Levitt, and I'm also hoping to hear from my friend Tom Ward in the back. So we're going to take...
So completely open.
That's exact. Soupy, very open dialogue.
For that GDA check 7 years ago.
Uh-oh.
My former friend Dan Rundy. Well, I guess I'm going to sleep really well at night because things are so great. And they are, I mean, as compared to past conversations, absolutely. But first, I just have to point out the fact that there's four times as much foreign direct investment money going into these countries doesn't have much to do with making those countries better places. It's going to make those companies that are investing richer. It may make the countries better, but it's not the same as development money. It's potentially the same. But my question is, I bet I could go through the list of companies that we're talking about and write 50% of them down from memory. They're the same companies. And they're really big, and they're in 150, or they're Coke in 200 and mm-hmm. more countries than there are countries.
Yeah.
And it's the same really small number of wonderful companies trying to do the same thing. How do we significantly expand the number, both of the big guys and mm-hmm. big companies, U.S. and so two questions. How do we expand the number? How do we expand to more medium-sized companies, and how do we get more non-U.S. companies to think that way?
And let's take Tom. Let's do this in a bunch, and we'll get Tom's, and then I'll give the panel a chance to.
Howdy, I'm Tom Ward. I'm an economist. Was at the World Bank for quite a while. Following up with what Trevor and Sarah said, I think is what's key here is we got to get past lofty ideas to down to the contracts. You know, so we get commonality of contracts and so forth. I've been working with the World Bank a lot. They've got links where you can go common contracts where you can get those, so it's inset. How you have a two-way accountability, and that's, again, goes back to the contract basis. And then understanding what the drivers are. So then we're all clear on what are we getting from the beginning.
Thanks, Tom. Okay, folks, just to give each of you a chance to respond to these.
Yeah.
Trevor, why don't you, we'll just start with you and we'll go down.
Okay.
Absolutely agree with the points that you made. It does tend to be the same larger companies. And part of that is the cost of being involved. The cost of engaging is actually relatively high. You know, to actually take something through the contracting process, whether it be the World Bank or AID, mm. DFID or the EU, if you're a small company, that's very difficult to do.
And expensive.
Just because of the actual transaction cost involved in doing it. So that in itself tends to be self-limiting. I think the other thing I would say is I think what we need to look at is building much more of an alliance for entrepreneurship. Yeah. Because if you look at where jobs are going to be...
Oh, sorry. We need to look much more about... Oh, you missed the best part. That's why you were all nodding.
Nodding.
God, see
it.
You were just thinking,
actually.
You were just thinking, thank God we can't hear him.
Right.
You were,
right.
Oh, thank God for that.
Words.
Okay. No, the second thing I would say is entrepreneurship. I think if you look at where you're going to create jobs in Africa, you're not going to create jobs through the big extractive companies. You're going to create wealth. You're going to drive GDP growth. You're going to drive exports. You're going to drive trade. You're not necessarily going to drive large numbers of jobs on the ground. You're going to do that through entrepreneurship. You're going to do that through SMEs, and you're going to do that through building up mm-hmm. that sort of. Well, I suppose it's probably critical. Middle class, really, in a sense, isn't it? It's the sense of people who are actually going to create growth in an economy. So I would urge development agencies to actually look at how they can actually develop entrepreneurship in these countries.
Sarah?
And I would agree with that, and I think, you know, if you're a medium-sized American company, you tend to keep your philanthropy local to whatever states you're doing business in, because it might not even be all 50. And the transaction costs are quite high. We can scale. It's when the Egypt project failed, or was, because we weren't sure what was going to happen with the government, if internet was ever going to get turned on, et cetera, you know, it didn't cost us any money not to do something. It was just a missed opportunity. Well, we could have done something in Ghana instead of Egypt, all that work we had done. But it didn't cost us. It didn't affect our bottom line, but for a small, medium-sized company, it could. And I think, and I always wish I could say this about my foreign competitors, because I do praise Microsoft and Cisco and HP and all of my U.S. competitors for doing great philanthropy in the U.S. and abroad. I think it's something that's kind of in our DNA as an American. As an American, you know, we've brought people over to show them how to volunteer, because that's not part of, you know, in the formal capacity of how we think about it as Americans. And exporting that and showing off, I think you're seeing it more when you have bigger non-U.S. companies that we're competing with going, well, wait, if Oracle's going over there to paint the school, why aren't we going over to paint our own school? And some of that, it's not a shame thing, but it's more of a lead by example. And I think that could help a bit.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to definitely associate myself with all the comments made by my colleagues here, and I couldn't agree more. Now, I'd like to take another lens on it, though. I mean, we will continue to work with those larger companies, because the ask that we have of them is a little different than what I think you're getting at. The ask is the ability to leverage their resources already going in, which I think is different than when you're talking about the medium-sized companies, where we're actually trying to grow the economies from the bottom. So I think our role in the next evolution is really how do we use our footprint across the world to replicate that within these local economies. When I think about the sea change that needs to happen, particularly when it comes to policy reform and the political will, the drivers are not necessarily going to be the multinationals in country. It's those local and regional powerhouses that we need to begin engaging as well. So that's a critical part of the dialogue. And then what we are doing on the entrepreneurship is really focusing on social entrepreneurship. So we've created mechanisms like our development innovation ventures, our grand challenges, which really speaks to a new cadre of people. And most of these are entrepreneurs that are coming up with these innovations and ideas. And in the last 3 years where we've had the DIBS and the global challenges, we've had over 6,000 people apply. And of those 6,000, over 65% are people who've never worked with USAID before. So we're doing it in a bite-sized chunk so that the issues that are barriers to entry aren't realized by them. And this is supporting them directly in those countries to become those engines of growth. So I think it is a valid point. We need to become more flexible in terms of how we engage along the entire spectrum, building on what we've learned from the bigger usual suspects, but actually applying them more nimbly to speak to the local needs and bring new ideas and thoughts and players to drive those economies.
Okay,
can I just add one more?
Sarah, you get the last one.
Sorry, about local economies. You know, companies of my size, we make money off wealth. I mean, we make money in Korea and Japan and Singapore. We don't make money in places like Burma and Laos because they don't have the economy. So when you don't have the vibrant middle class, you're spending money on food aid. You're not spending money on an IT system for healthcare. Mm-hmm. You're buying an inoculation pack. You're not buying, you know, an inventory management system. And that's where we want to see these countries grow. It's not to our benefit to keep them, you know, to keep that lower to keep things down.
We want to see people prosper and grow because it's in everybody's interest.
And I think, yeah, and, you know, Lee Kuan Yew said, you know, the three things you need to do for wealth when he was prime minister his first year was emancipate women, create foreign direct investment, and improve education. And you do those three things and things will flourish on their own. Now, Singapore is a special thing.
Amen.
We have, 40% of Oracle are female. The person who ran Malaysia was female. The person who ran Pakistan was female up until a few years ago. Those types of things also to bring up that, you know, the kitchen cabinet of women in tech and women in business, we try to lead by example. And I
We're going to set change now. We're going to go up to the second panel. I hope everyone, if those who, folks standing in the back, if you were standing because you couldn't find a seat, there's some seats up front, and we're going to, if you can, up here, there's some seats up front here, and we're going to do a quick set change. Thanks, panel.
Dan, thank you.
Okay.
Change. Can I make one? Our cards are still new. I mentioned we launched last week. The website is www.usa.gov/globaldevlab for those interested.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay, set change. All right.
Okay,
folks. Thank you. Thank you. I'm really appreciative that we've got some really thoughtful people that we're going to take it now to a slightly different optic, which is we're going to talk about livelihoods and the post-2015 goals. We've got some really great speakers. My friend Barbara Kreisler, I'm going to ask her to speak first. I don't think I need to go into the same level of detail, given that you've all been here for the first panel. But I think what we're doing is we're going to take this conversation a little bit further about the power of partnerships. But I am going to come back to the question at the end for my colleagues on, okay, what do you guys need from governments and multilateral organizations? And a little bit, I want a little bit direct the question from my non-private sector folks to my friend from UNIDO. And then I'm going to have put to Barbara, what do you need from the private sector? And at the end, but after you've presented, that'll be my one question, then we'll go out. Okay, so Barbara, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Dan. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a pleasure to be here today, and thanks a lot for the CSIS for supporting us in this endeavor. As my colleague Kazuki said just an hour ago, we are actually kickstarting today, in collaboration with the CSIS, our consultations on the partnership with the private sector within the post-2015 development framework. And we're doing that together with the UN Global Compact because both organizations, UNIDO and the UN Global Compact, have been nominated to lead this agenda. So we're very excited about the opportunity today. I would like to, before I start talking about the importance of sustainable livelihoods and poverty eradication, I would like to, as Trevor was actually doing, just to take us a little step back and to look at the Millennium Development Goals and their achievements. And I think there have been some impressive results after all. First of all, the last 13 years have seen the fastest reduction in poverty in human history. And we have seen, for instance, a fall in 30% of child mortality. And also the death from malaria have fallen by a quarter. These are just three examples, but I think they do show that there have been some impressive results. Nevertheless, we also have to acknowledge that there have been some serious shortcomings with the Millennium Development Goals. First of all, they did not manage to integrate social, environmental, and economic aspects of sustainable development. Second, neither did they address the economic growth as a critical driver to generate the income in order to address the other two dimensions, namely social and environmental priorities. And thirdly, they also did not have in place an implementation mechanism to achieve these goals. Now we have the historic opportunity in the development of the new post-2015 development agenda to address these shortcomings, and at the same time to also address some of the major changes that have actually been happening since the year 2000 and that are going to happen within the next 15 years. We should not forget that by the year 2030, we'll probably have another billion people, additional 1 billion people on this planet. Most of us are also living in cities today. Mobile phone subscriptions have actually risen to more than 6 billion by now, and the internet has virtually available in all corners of the world. So while the international development community, or international community, I should say, is busily trying to develop the new set of goals, one theme that we believe is going to be central in this debate is the eradication of extreme poverty within the next generation. And I would like to actually quote the high-level panel of eminent persons that the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon has put in place as one of the consultative groups to work on the post-2015 agenda. And that group quoted in their report, and I'm quoting here, "For the first time in history, there's a chance to do something that has never been done before, and that is to eradicate extreme poverty once and for all, to end hunger, illiteracy, and preventable death. This would be a truly historic achievement." So how can this be done? Obviously, poverty eradication is a multidimensional challenge, and it will go far beyond my presentation today to look into all these dimensions. What I would like to argue today in my presentation is that industry, if we are serious about eradicating extreme poverty by the year 2030, industry has to be at the key of this endeavor. Let's look at some of the dimensions of poverty eradication and the creation of sustainable livelihoods. For instance, job creation. Jobs are a principal way out of poverty. They boost living standards, raise productivity, and foster social cohesion. At this very moment, the world has to tackle a double challenge. First of all, we need to find jobs for the 200 million people out there that currently are without a job. And according to World Bank estimates, another 600 million jobs will have to be created by the year 2020. And secondly, these jobs need to be good and decent jobs, because a third of all workers worldwide are still poor, and out of that, more than half are actually still in the informal sector, mostly of them women. However, jobs do not fall from heaven like manna, and job creation is a very difficult and challenging thing to do that most governments of the world are struggling with. Job and employment opportunities arise, as we've heard already in the first panel, from enterprise creation, from smart government policies, and from economic development. And I agree, about 90% of all enterprises worldwide are SMEs. So SMEs have a very important function in that. With more than 500 million jobs globally, manufacturing is absolutely crucial for employment generation. But sustained job creation also requires structural change. That means the ability of economies to constantly innovate and to constantly generate fast-growing activities that are characterized by higher value added, higher productivity, and increasing returns to scale. In this, since the Industrial Revolution, manufacturing has been at the core of structural change. constantly creating higher output employment and leading to unprecedented growth in incomes. The second dimension I'd like to look at is food security. Poverty is the main cause of hunger. In fact, people go hungry because they cannot afford food. And the price volatility and sharp increases in some of basic foods and staple food has not helped. Food security, however, is not just about getting people enough food. It is also about access, it is about managing waste, and it is about moving towards sustainable production and consumption patterns. Producing more food will be absolutely essential. By the year 2030, we will need about 50% more food than it is currently produced today. Here again, industry is absolutely key. The agricultural sector does remain the backbone of economic development and livelihood creation in nearly all developing countries. However, most smallholder farmers are trapped in a vicious cycle of subsistence. And that is mainly because they do not produce enough yield to have enough surpluses that can be marketed and marketable. And second, because there are missing links and lack of infrastructure between farm-level production and processes, manufacturing, and marketing. Agricultural and industrial development here are absolutely crucial to help smallholder farmers to move from the subsistence level to increasing and successful businesses that can generate income, that can produce nutritious food, and that can actually stimulate growth and reduce poverty. With these changes, we can feed another billion people by the year 2030. The last dimension I would like to look at is actually sustainable management of natural resources. Industry has a very important role, as I just mentioned, in food security and job creation, but we cannot deny that industry also has a major ecological footprint and causes severe pollution around the planet. If we continue the current industrial and wasteful model that is built on the scarce natural resources that we have, we are definitely bound for serious ecological, social, and economic disaster. So obviously, we need to do something differently. And I think the key here is what we call decoupling. Decoupling of economic growth from unsustainable resource use and negative environmental impact. Decoupling means to use less material, to lose less water, and to use less energy for the same economic output. It also means to move away from resource-intensive production to resource-efficient productivity. In conclusion, I would like to say that industrial development has proven a very effective poverty reduction strategy for the last centuries. What is important now in the post-2015 development debate is to acknowledge industry's key role in achieving comprehensive and sustainable development outcomes. As such, we would argue that industry must have a prominent role in the post-2015 development agenda and feature in the sustainable development goals in order to address the eradication of poverty once and for all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Barbara. Caitlin, we're so appreciative you're here with Hilton Worldwide. You've been a great partner to CSIS along with IYF in helping us launch the Youth Wellbeing Index and to help us launch a larger initiative around youth prosperity and security. You all think about the issue of employment as it's linked to the travel and hospitality industry, and the issues of employment are a critical business opportunity and challenge for your industry. Thank you for being here, and the floor is yours.
Great. Thank you so much for having us. I'm really excited to be here and apologize for my froggy voice. I'm recovering from a cold. So to give you a little bit of an introduction of Hilton Worldwide, first of all, as many of my colleagues, we are a global company. We operate 10 different hotel brands, so you're probably familiar with our flagship brand, which is Hilton Hotels and Resorts. We also own Hampton Inns, Embassy Suites, DoubleTree, Waldorf. We have a large portfolio. We have about 4,000 hotels in 90 countries around the world, and we employ in those hotels over 300,000 team members. So because of that, we're obviously a services industry company. There's huge opportunity for us. We're at a point in our history where we're growing faster than we ever have in our 92 years of operation. And so we're looking at needing to hire a lot of people in the coming years. We're also really growing most quickly outside of the United States. Often in a lot of markets where we don't have a lot of familiarity, we don't have hotels there, and a lot of people in the room have been working there for a long time. So for us, as we started thinking about, you know, these issues of growth and being more strategic with our investments, we looked at where it made sense to start looking at partnerships to overcome some of these employability issues. So some of you might have heard at the World Economic Forum this year, we made a commitment to open doors for 1 million young people by 2019, and we plan to do that by connecting with them, ideally through our supply chain and through other means, by preparing them, and that's looking at workforce development programs, mentoring programs, internships with our hotels, and just general awareness raising of hospitality as a career opportunity for young people. And then finally through employing them and bringing them as team members, providing them good jobs, providing them opportunity to grow, and giving them the skills they need so that if they stay with us, they can be successful, or if they decide to go elsewhere, then they can also be successful and contribute. So as you can imagine, a multinational company does not come to this position of making a commitment like this lightly. It's something we started thinking about 3 years ago when my colleague and boss, Jennifer Silberman, joined us as our Vice President of Corporate Responsibility. And we decided to start thinking about corporate responsibility more strategically and looking at, you know, what are the issues over the long term that are most going to impact our business? What are the things that if we aren't paying attention to them, we will not be able to operate 50 years from now, 100 years from now? And one of the things we came up with was our team members. Obviously, we cannot serve our guests without our team members. We cannot operate our hotels without our team members. So that is a critical stakeholder group for us. Further, we looked at our team members inevitably will be aging. So how are we looking at the next generation of team members? And so we came to young people and youth as an area that was of real importance to us. And as we started looking at the issue of youth, especially youth in all of the markets where we're expanding so quickly, we realized that we're really good at, once people come to us and apply for that job, bringing them into our system, helping to train them, helping to give them the skills that they need, the knowledge that they need to do really well within our hotels. But in some of the markets where we were going, they weren't coming to us at that point of being ready. You know, that they were coming out of university, certainly, but maybe they weren't coming out with the skills that matched up with our needs, or they weren't coming out with the, you know, soft skills, even, that we really needed for them to be successful. And so we realized that we needed to look outside of just our own expertise to other sectors, to people who had been operating in these contexts for a long time, and find an expert partner that could help advise us along this journey. So we developed a partnership with the International Youth Foundation, and they've been really instrumental in working with us and better understanding how to tackle this issue of youth, bringing them on board and kind of integrating them into our whole system. So we've worked with them really closely. We started out doing a lot of research around youth as it relates to hospitality, them coming into our hotels, what are the barriers and where are the opportunities when we do bring them in. We found out that travel and tourism will need to hire about 73 million people in approximately the next 10 years, while simultaneously there are about 75 million unemployed youth. So matches up pretty nicely in our opinion. But as with a lot of these things, you know, the devil is in that last mile of, you know, what is it that's keeping them from being able to come in and contribute with our company? So they've also helped us greatly in some targeted markets where we're growing to create specific programming. As those of you who might be familiar with them, they have a great network among universities, among foreign governments, you know, and helped us to look at kind of the whole ecosystem as we're going into these countries. You know, it's not like here where you can just expect people to come out of university and be ready. You've got to be thinking about who are the different players involved. And so through that work, we started to realize that, you know, we are a global company. We can provide this job for these young people, which is, you know, a great position to be in. A lot of our colleagues don't have kind of that scale and the need to hire so many people. But we also realized that we're only one component of overall youth well-being. Right, so we can give them the job, but if they're not healthy, if they're not safe at home, if they don't have the educational resources they need, they're not going to be able to succeed long term with us or otherwise. And so IYF, you know, started talking to us and saying, you know, there isn't really a great way to measure this or to assess youth well-being across, you know, across countries and across different factors like that. And so with their advice and then with the leadership of CSIS, we supported the development of the Youth Wellbeing Index, which was released last week and was a fantastic job by this team. And the index looks at six different areas of youth well-being. It's across an international scope, so it covers about 70% of the world's youth. And the thought being was that if we, with these partners, could develop a tool, governments could use it to target their funding more effectively. Private sector could use it to know where to invest, you know, in the different countries they're going into. The nonprofit sector could use it to better understand, you know, where they're making their investments. Foundations, same thing. So we're really excited about the potential for the tool. So I think you can kind of see, you know, that we've really evolved in our thinking and in our approach and just in our understanding of the issue, you know, over the last couple of years. But ultimately what we've realized is that none of us in this room, whether you're with government, whether you're with private sector, whether you're with nonprofit, whether you're, you know, education, whatever, we don't operate in a vacuum. You know, all of us are kind of interdependent as it relates to handling any of these kind of larger scaled issues. And so we really realize that we can contribute our knowledge and expertise in as much as we have to offer, but we really need to look for that expertise coming from everyone who's really affecting these issues if we're really going to look at kind of this long-term sustainable growth and sustainable change. So that's our story, and I'm excited to get your questions and talk further.
Thank you so much, Caitlin. Tom, you're at Land O'Lakes. When I think about Land O'Lakes, I think about butter, but I don't think in this context we're necessarily talking about butter. But Barbara, I think, very interestingly talked about both the food and urbanization challenges and how we're going to need to feed folks. And at the same time, we've still got a lot of rural poverty in the world, and how are we going to connect people to global markets, including agricultural markets, which are global markets. So, Tom, the floor is yours.
Thanks very much, Dan. I really appreciate the invitation from you and from the center to come and speak here today. That's right. Everybody knows Land O'Lakes. You probably buy and use our products, our dairy products, our butter products. But we're a little bit more than the dairy company. We are actually the second largest cooperative in the United States. We have about 5,000 individual farmer members. We have 900 cooperatives that have over 300,000 farmers. So we're a multifaceted agribusiness with very, very strong roots in the Midwest. The Land O'Lakes, as everyone knows, of course, is the state of Minnesota because it has over 10,000 lakes. So we're a really solid Midwestern company. I came to work for Land O'Lakes in 2009, and one of the reasons I really love working at Land O'Lakes is one of the number one value at the company is integrity. And I really like the remarks heard earlier. You know, I don't think you can be a successful private business today anywhere in the world if you don't operate with integrity. And I was really, really pleased when I came to Land O'Lakes and I learned that was the number one value they expect in their employees and everything else. We work with a lot of partners in the United States, and because of that, I tend to think of Land O'Lakes as a relationship company. And I want to talk about relationships because that's what really these public-private partnerships are all about. Land O'Lakes, in addition to being a dairy company, we're the number one animal feed company in the United States. Purina is our brand. And we've recently gone international with a joint venture in the PRC, the People's Republic of China. Again, it's a relationship we've made with a company out of Taiwan, and we now have an animal feed investment in the People's Republic of China. We've also recently gone international into Mexico. We have just invested in a tropical maize or corn seed production plant down there. We're interested in expanding into tropical maize seed because, as Barbara mentioned, the demand for food is only going to increase around the world. Land O'Lakes is actually the number two seed company in the United States. You're not going to see us in Home Depot or in your garden supply stores because we sell wholesale through our cooperatives. But we have proprietary rights to hybrid corn, hybrid soy, and hybrid alfalfa or lucerne. And as you can imagine, this complements well our dairy farmers, because what do dairy farmers need? They need corn, they need soy, source of protein, and they need grasses, which is what corn and alfalfa are, to feed their dairy cows, okay? So I don't work in the corporate side, though. I work in the international development side. What? Land O'Lakes does international development work? I didn't know that. Well, we do. 32 years ago, our CEO decided, just like we're good neighbors in the communities we work in the American Midwest and throughout North America now, we should be a good neighbor in the world. And so he created our division, the International Development Division, and we operate mainly on grants and contracts from the U.S. Department of Agriculture and from USAID. So I want to talk a little bit about what we bring to the table and why we have a unique value proposition to offer in development work. First of all, I think there is a really important place for development work to complement private sector investment, because I really believe development money helps prime the pump. It helps come in and do some of the things that Caitlin was talking about in terms of education and that Sarah was talking about with the teachers and the schools. And some of our work, and I'm going to talk specifically in a minute or two about Sri Lanka, it really starts to prime the pump so that communities are ready for investments that are going to come in by larger companies. So again, we're a relationship company, but we take a market-driven approach. We're an agribusiness, we're a cooperative. So when we go in and start a project that's being funded by USDA or USAID, we don't go in there and try and, you know, look for something to do. We look at what the market wants. And what we try to do, again, as a relationship company, is connect farmers to markets. And we move all along that value chain from the farm to the fork, okay? And we work with companies all along there. I want to make this clear. Right now, Land O'Lakes does not have any investments or brands that we are selling in any of the less developed countries that we're working in. Okay, so if you go to the Land O'Lakes website, you will see under the corporate social responsibility the work that I and my colleagues do. Okay, so we're not out there trying to even develop a market for Land O'Lakes. That was not what the vision was when our division was established. But for example, because we're a cooperative, when we go into some of these countries, what's the first thing that we think about doing? We think about organizing farmers. Why? Because if you've got five farmers out there, nobody who's selling hybrid seed or fertilizer, soil fertility products, or anything else has a sales force that's going to go and visit all five farmers or 500 farmers. But if you join them together in a cooperative or a farmer-based organization, and you have one person representing them, now you have a value proposition. Maybe I'll come and I'll visit this representative and I'll be able to sell or at the same time buy from them. As a dairy company, our most successful stories are organizing farmers into dairy cooperatives around milk collection centers, hooking them up with processors. But one of the areas we're working in, I just want to talk briefly about it, is Sri Lanka. Those of you who watch the news and are aware of international events know that Sri Lanka was one of the countries hit by the tsunami.
Ten years ago.
Right, in 04. They also had a civil war that was going on there for about 30 years between the Tamil Tigers, sounds like a soccer team, and the regime in Colombo. So when the civil war ended, USAID and the government of Sri Lanka wanted to go into these areas and start generating economic growth. So we have a project called Biz Plus, where we're working to develop grassroots small and medium enterprises in Sri Lanka. So far, we've made $8 million in direct grants to these small businesses. And the way it works is we go out, we visit these businesses. Many of them don't even have a business plan. They don't know what a business plan is. Many of them aren't keeping books that might be acceptable at banks. So we go in, we do some training, we provide some technical assistance. Then we cross the street, we work with the banks, explain to the banks, look, this looks like a bankable proposition. Again, building those relationships between those small and medium enterprises that need a little capital to hire more people. We have a key partnership with the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce at the national level, and they are the ones who are going to sort of carry forward the activities in terms of providing these business development services to the small and medium enterprises we've helped grow in the northern and eastern parts of Sri Lanka. We've given grants to ag cooperatives for the production, transformation, and marketing of dairy and other products. We've helped with cattle breeding services and artificial insemination services. We've helped businesses in tea packaging, core, which is coconut fiber. Sri Lanka has a lot of coconut trees. For processing, we've helped establish ice production facilities for fisheries. We've worked with small manufacturers to develop agricultural machinery for smallholder farmers. And we've even done some work in shoe, garment, furniture, handicrafts, and other small and medium enterprises.
Sounds like you guys do a lot.
We're doing a lot. We've also worked directly with 300 micro-enterprise firms. So directly, we've created 5,000 new jobs. And through these micro-enterprises that work to support the SMEs, we've created another 6,200 jobs. In sum, what we're really doing is trying to facilitate the transfer of knowledge, information, and skills, building up relationships of trust between these small and medium enterprises, the customers they're serving, the financial institutions that are giving them credit, and encouraging the adoption of modern technologies and modern business practices. And I look forward to taking any questions. And my colleague, my former colleague, Matt Krause, who helped develop that program, is sitting out here in the audience, Great. And he's probably better qualified to speak about it than me.
Thanks, Tom.
Thanks.
Deirdre, thanks for being on the panel. You're the CEO of Pixera Global. You bring both volunteers and professionals. You've worked at the nexus of companies. As you think about supply chains, you've been a leader on international corporate volunteerism. Most of your work, compared to say 10 or 20 years ago, is not with the U.S. government. You work primarily with companies. You're a solutions provider for companies, often in partnership and connecting them, in essence, a development solutions provider. You work with the U.S. government still. But you really have your journey, I think, is symbolic of some of the cutting edge of international development partners in terms of how they the forward leaning ones have thought differently about working with the private sector. So I'm really appreciate you being on this panel, and I appreciate also having joined your board recently. So
I was just going
to
say,
not only am I a client, but I'm a board member, right? Like
those
TV ads,
nice
right?
Things.
Exactly.
So thanks, Dan, and thanks for inviting me to be here today, and thank you all for being here, and thanks to CSIS for hosting this really interesting afternoon. And just even on this panel, I heard a lot of very common themes, starting with relationships, which we definitely tend to be a bit of a relationship organization ourselves. I appreciated your comments on direct business interest in the programming that you're doing, Caitlin, and I think that that's very aligned with what we're doing. And then Barbara, just sort of the what are we doing to move the needle on big global challenges. So all of those things play in quite a bit to the work that Pixera Global does. Let me tell you a little bit about our history, because I think that, as Dan alluded to, it is very much related to the discussion we're having today. So
We've been around for 25 years. We've only been Pixera Global since October, so we're all still getting used to the name. The gentleman who was sitting up front and is now hiding in the back that asked the cynical question at the end of the last session is my predecessor as CEO at CDC Development Solutions.
He's an affiliate here at CSI, so it's all very in the family.
Yes.
But he groomed me in my cynicism for a dozen years, so that may come into our business strategy as well. So we began 25 years ago as an organization that was started after the fall of the Berlin Wall, when American businessmen and women were calling into the White House. They wanted to do something to help businesses that were transitioning to working in a market economy in Eastern Europe and then the countries of the former Soviet Union. And so we really were, in the early days, a broker of skilled volunteer services. That's one real area of expertise of our organization. Over time, we shifted to be more of an international development provider that used skilled volunteer resources wherever that was appropriate to do. And we really shifted to being a USAID contractor and grantee. We were, up until a decade ago, 100% funded by USAID. And today, we're less than 10% funded by USAID. And the way that we made that journey was by looking at the areas of expertise we had, the placing of skilled volunteers, and also understanding entrepreneurship, understanding SME growth in emerging economies, and where all of those pieces intersected. So there's I want to give you three specific examples of projects we do to give you a sense of where the public sector, private sector, and social sector all come into this. We ourselves are a 501c3. We're an NGO, and one of our key areas of work is in local content development, particularly for the extractive industries. And what we do in that area is we will work as a contractor, usually for an oil and gas company, to identify local businesses that have the potential to be suppliers to the industry, and then to work with them to build their capacity to meet the very stringent requirements of the industry, whether that's in quality management or financial management, health, safety, and environment, all of the things that are not necessarily at the top of an entrepreneur in Angola or Mozambique's mind when they're thinking about the opportunities in the oil and gas sector. So we've done that work since the 1990s in Sakhalin in Russia, but today we have, I think, the most interesting project we've ever done in this space, and that is in Mozambique, working with Anadarko Oil Company. And Anadarko is a Houston-based company and a very American company, and they've only just started making a foray into working internationally. And all of a sudden, they have this massive gas concession off the coast of northern Mozambique. And there is a lot of talk in the country about upcoming requirements for procurement of local goods and services. And Anadarko didn't really know what to do with those requirements. And so we came along and we worked with them to do a very intensive gap analysis. What does the industry need and what's actually available on the local market? And what is going to need to be done in order to bring the local market up to meet the standards? Now, this kind of work has been done in a lot of countries before. What's different here is that Anadarko is not yet at final investment decision, and yet they have invested heavily in understanding and starting to build the capacity of these potential local suppliers. And the other thing they've done that's really different and exciting in this space is they have turned to their FEED contractors, the front-end engineering and design contractors, the Bechtels and Fluors and Halliburtons of the world, and said, when you bid for the build-out of this liquefied natural gas facility, we need you to build into your proposal how you're going to maximize local content. So this has never been done before. Everywhere else we've ever been working on local content, we're retrofitting it in a situation where they've already been producing for years and years. So think about the potential of that if you build, if you design a facility so that you can maximize the use of local content. It's a really, really exciting model, and we're hoping that we're going to see some uptick on it as there are so many more new oil and gas producers around the world and so many people that are struggling with their local content policy, so many countries that are struggling with their local content policies. So that's one piece. The other area of our work that we're best known for is what Dan spoke about earlier, which is international corporate volunteer programs. So some of you may have heard of IBM's Corporate Service Corps program. It's probably the gold standard in this space because IBM sends 500 people a year, their top talent, to work on assignments building the capacity of local governments, SMEs, NGOs around the world. And we're responsible for finding those host clients, for conducting needs assessment and seeing what they could actually use of the skills that we have available from IBM, and then matching the right skill sets with the needs of those local organizations. And IBM's been doing this for 5 years now, and there are now, we just finished our benchmark study this year, there are now 39 major companies that have programs akin to the Corporate Service Corps program, where companies are sending out their top talent. They are looking for leadership development, they're looking for insight into emerging markets, they're looking for teaming because it's a global corporation. They're eventually looking to profit from doing this, but at the same time they're delivering real social value, social impact.
Okay, so what you're saying is this isn't CSR?
No, this is not CSR.
Right? So I think the thing you want to take away is what you're hearing in either case, the localization of supply chains, which are billions and billions of dollars, multiples of foreign assistance or even corporate philanthropy, plugging small SMEs in local economies into that. There's some controversies in this country about that among large companies, and it impacts some of our trading relationships, et cetera. But it is, there's a changing landscape out there, and there are increased pressures to do it. And so I think in the net, you're going to see a lot more companies doing this. So Pixera helps them do that. But then the international corporate volunteerism, when if we'd had this conversation 10 years ago or even 5 years ago, the conversation around corporate volunteerism was, this is a nice to do. Maybe it's a staff retention thing. Now it's the kind of program that IBM is doing, which 700?
They send 500 a year. They've sent 2,500 total over
2,500 total. So we're now getting into the thousands of the best people that a large global company has into local markets. Isn't necessarily about, isn't this wonderful from an employee retention standpoint? This is about very sophisticated business development work, as well as team building, and so there are very specific so linking development challenges with, if I can put it this way, self-interest or good business practices is where it's at. And I also think it's interesting, so Pixera going from, I don't know, 100% of its resourcing from governments to 95% or 90% private sector in the last 25 years, I think says something about the way the world is going. So let me go back, and I'm going to go back to each of you, and then I want to put this out to the audience for questions. Is okay, just very briefly, Deirdre, Tom, Caitlin, what do you need from the UNIDOs of the world for you to do more partnerships? And then Barbara, briefly, what do you need from the private sector or from other sectors for you to scale your partnerships? Deirdre, you go first.
So I think the thing that's been really frustrating for us, and that we haven't seen from the public sector, and in some cases from our NGO colleagues either, is an acceptance of this fact that it's okay for business to profit from doing this kind of work. It's okay, and in fact, we welcome it, and that's going to allow them to continue to do it. And even though some of us sit here, we nod at this table, that's not sort of the prevailing, that's not the prevailing feeling, and we've got to change where we are on that.
That's good. Okay.
Yeah, I really appreciated the comments that we got about the new office and the Global Development Alliance. But one of the disconnects, and my experience has mostly been with USAID, is that while we can have these policies in Washington, the money's not in Washington. The money's in the field. And so as many times as the administrator or other people may say, we want public-private partnerships, sometimes when you approach a mission with an idea, the idea doesn't get too far. Or if it gets far and then there's a change in who's heading up one office and a new person comes into the office, that idea dies. And, you know, that's kind of difficult. So what I would like to see is everyone on the same page, that if aid is going to have a policy in Washington, that somehow there's a way to ensure that the missions follow along with it. The second thing is to streamline the paperwork. I like the KPMG remarks about the energy footprint. I think the application process, the amount of paperwork that's needed, the reporting requirements and everything for public-private partnerships are far too onerous. And it was cited as a reason why small and medium companies can't get into it, why a company like Oracle or KPMG can bear it. So those are my two takeaways.
Thank you. Caitlin.
Yeah, and I'd say from our perspective, you know, we are looking, like you said, for those opportunities that are a win for the business and are a win for society. It's a shared value concept, and that's where we really try and target our investments. That being said, we want to partner with organizations that are thinking about that, and they're thinking about, as a hospitality company, what unique resources and expertise can we bring to these issues to help move the needle. And hopefully that's not only money and hotel rooms, which is what we hear from most of the organizations that approach us about partnership, but it's really thinking about, like, we have a army of 300,000 people on the ground in 90 countries. We have people in every one of our hotels. They're like a little mini business. We have accountants, we have marketing people, we've got communications people, we've got these experts, you know, that are all over the world. We've got, you know, this whole network of actual infrastructure out there. We've got a supply chain of over $3 billion worth of, you know, things coming in. So being a little bit more creative about what we can bring to the table, and then once we get some of those ideas, providing us some tangible next steps. I think that I attend a lot of meetings that are really fantastic around ideating about the issues and how can we come to them and how can we talk about public-private partnerships, and it is very fantastic. But we're ready to go. Like, you know, give us some instructions and some tangible next steps we can take, and, like, let's go.
Okay, Barbara, so I think you've got your marching, some stuff in your inbox here, but what's your response from you're at a multilateral agency, thinks about the private sector. What do you need from the private sector for you to scale what you do in your day job in Vienna?
Right. Well, I think obviously a lot of that has already been said in the first and also here in the second panel. I very much agree. I think what I would like to stress one more time is that we need to sharpen the business case. We need to sharpen the value proposition that each partner can bring to the table. And it's absolutely clear, at least for the organization I work for, UNIDO, that the business is business. You guys will never be a philanthropic outfit, and you shouldn't. But I think there's a lot that you can bring to the table. We certainly, and I think the areas where, or the times when the development community was looking at the private sector simply as a cash cow, hopefully these times are over. We are really looking at the private sector as bringing knowledge and expertise to our technical cooperation programs. And then I was listening to what Tom was saying, and the example he gave about Sri Lanka made me smile, because the way you were describing the project, I mean, I wasn't sure now whether you were actually from the private sector or from the development community, because it very much shows the overlapping interest and the convergence between the interest of the private sector and the development community. And so strengthening this business case and making sure we can further align CSR with business interest, I think this is really what we need to work for.
Okay, got time for one or two questions from the audience. This gentleman here, Jeremiah, actually my other colleague will get you the microphone. Right here, this gentleman, and anyone else? Now's your moment. Okay. And this woman back here, so it's going to be the two of you. Go ahead.
Mark Bryan, United Nations Foundation. We've been doing, actually, a number of private sector engagements and dialogues on the post-2015 agenda with our partners in the Global Compact. So I've read a good bit about what companies are thinking of in sort of general terms of what needs to be built into the post-2015 process. I'd like to hear from the panel your thoughts on processes and policies that you see as integral to helping you in your work built into the process, and feel free to get granular.
And this young woman back here, Jeremiah's got right behind you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for a really informative panel session. I'm Helen Cho. I actually work for Ricardo, and I'm with USAID Global Partnerships team. My question is around, I wanted to take advantage of this opportunity where we have private sector representatives to really validate this value that we bring to the table as government and part of, the USG, of the convening power when we're saying that we as representatives of the U.S. government bring to the table the relationships with the ministry officials in country, with other bilaterals. That's where we can add value because we, you know, have those relationships. Is that something that the private sector sees as valuable depending on the country that we're working in? And how can we really leverage that value if that is the case?
So I'm going to have Deirdre, and we're just going to go on down, and I'm going to have Barbara Kreisler have the last word. But Deirdre, you're first.
So I want to give a really frank answer to the question that you just posed. We work to create a lot of those relationships on the ground because most of the work we do is not with and through USAID. Frankly, we find that it is easier to broker those relationships bilaterally sometimes than it is to bring in a whole nother level of formality and process that comes with bringing the U.S. government into the mix. I would love for it to be otherwise. So in that list of asks, but right now, we find it easier to go at our own and to bring our clients along on that than to triangulate it. So I'd be happy to work with you on that.
I think it. The level of the American ambassador, there's certainly a convening power. In most countries I've worked in, and I've worked in over 30 countries in the developing world, the U.S. ambassador usually has a round table where he calls in representatives of American businesses or retailers and things like that. And certainly there's an advantage for that for networking and other purposes. But I absolutely agree with Deirdre. I got some funding from our overhead to do a pilot project in Kenya for 3 years. And I did it, you know, completely, you know, without, you know, telling anybody in USAID or the U.S., you know, embassy or anything like that. I went and made the relationships with the Kenyan companies, with the representatives of Monsanto, Syngenta, Bayer, and the other crop protection and companies I wanted to work with to, you know, try this pilot project and see if it would work. After the first year, of course, then I made sure I went to the embassy in aid and let them know about it because I did want to get a GDA, and that's another story. I think, you know, that's about enough said on that. In terms of the post-2015 agenda, one of the things we talked about in the green room, and I know Dan brought it up, is not just the private sector and what our role is going to be, but what's going to be the role of the developing countries in determining the priorities for the post-2015 development agenda. I mean, we talked earlier, I think there was reference to the fact that there were 8 Millennium Development Goals leading up to 2015, and now there's talk of being 30, talk of being 50, talk of being 100. I mean, as Dan said earlier, not to get too religious on this, but Christ had 12 disciples. There were 10 commandments.
That I didn't say, though.
Yeah, I know. But, you know,
I agree with that, but I'm not.
Once you start getting into double digits like that, I think you're just going to lose focus. So, you know, the fewer the numbers for us as an agricultural company, the better.
Okay, Caitlin.
Great. To follow up on that, I think clarity around what exactly we can do to contribute would be really helpful. And I'm talking about specific metrics. How are we measuring success? And how can businesses contribute? How can government contribute? How can nonprofits contribute? But how are we measuring it and how will we know? Because I think we've talked a lot about whether it's successful, whether it's not. And so getting clarity on that would be really helpful, although I recognize that's very difficult. And then finally, to the relationships for going into countries. A lot of our You know, when we're going into new countries, a lot of that is kind of handled on the ground. So the development teams there will be handling it. When we're, you know, working with the teams to build out our teams, we'll work with local universities. And so we come in areas where we're really struggling. But I think I would agree probably with my colleagues that we're moving fast. And so adding that additional level of formality would probably be challenging for us. But also agree that, you know, if it were there in a way that would we could utilize more easily, would certainly be welcome.
Okay, Barbara, you have the last word. And if you can also reflect a little bit on this question from our friend from the UN Foundation.
Sure. I mean, I think what, and in fact, we did talk about this already previous to this session. Certainly, we need to ensure that we integrate the social, economic, and environmental dimension into this discussion, because this is something that has not happened in the development of the MDGs. Neither did the private sector at all have a voice in the development of the 8 MDGs. So I think just the change that we are seeing now, and I think we also need to give some credit to that in the last 15 years, there has been a tremendous change, because nowadays you have CEOs of the top companies of this world that are actively being engaged in the development of the new development framework. So in that sense, I think that is already a very important move. I also would like to echo what Kathleen was saying, that I think what would be very important from the private sector is to get guidance and lead on how can we monitor success. Because that is something, how can we actually make sure that we don't say we are doing great things, but we can actually build a framework and we can build certain indicators that can actually help us to measure success. And that is tremendously challenging and complex. And I think we will certainly look at the private sector to help us in guide us in that, because that is certainly something where you guys have a lot of experience and expertise that we can actually use. I would like to just also finish by saying that this consultative process on the means of implementation is actually taking place as we speak. It is taking place at the national, regional, and global level. And we are inviting the private sector in all the countries where this consultation process is taking place to come in and to make their voices heard. We have also launched a website, The World We Want 2015, where we are publishing some of the key documentations from all stakeholders that have a stake in this process. And we very much would invite you also to have a look at it and to contribute to that. Thanks.
Please join me in thanking the two panels.